Hi, everybody. A quick introduction about myself. I am the founder and CCO of UXUS, which means you times us. I have a fashion background. I was a Parsons graduate and also the creative director of apparel at Nike for many years. UXUS is an agency that creates brand experiences from built environments all the way through branded rituals. So we do the entire scope of a consumer's experience in store. So post, pre, during, and post, not only the physical space, but also the experiences themselves, the things that need to be scripted, that, you know, whoever it is that's interacting with the consumer would do for them. To get started, I want to talk about something that I think is incredibly relevant. I put this presentation together much, much prior to this whole coronavirus situation. And I think that it's incredibly relevant today more than ever in terms of what the future of luxury means. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to share the screen right now and pull up the presentation. Here we go. Talk a little bit about what the future of luxury means. And the reason I titled The Future of Luxury is Invisible is because, especially today, think about what's happening with coronavirus and the division of class and how aware people are between people that have a lot and people who have very little, and how people who have a lot are looking to escape the whole crisis. Go to different places that are maybe not as congested, you know, obviously, you know, try to survive the best they can, just like everybody else. So what does that mean for luxury in the future? Recently, luxury has been about big logos. Everybody has wanted to have like a big logo and the kind of 19th century mentality about status. So ownership, price, to indicate where you are in society. This is a trend that has been changing already with youth for many, many years now, and especially Gen Z and the later part of millennials really are looking to define status in a completely new way. And what I'm gonna show you today are some experiences that are out there in the market. Some of it is not new at all. So some of it has actually been around for a long time, and for certain individuals who are kind of the trendsetters in the market, this type of luxury has always been what has been considered premium. So my first statement I'd like to say is the future of luxury is ungoogleable, and luxury has become so ubiquitous. Think about Louis Vuitton, Gucci. All the brands out there that are pushing quote unquote luxury experiences that are basically upper middle class experiences. So a lot of people in the world own and know about everything. Google has allowed us to search and become knowledgeable about anything you want to become. So if we look at luxury in the sense of rarity and the sense of exclusivity, then luxury has to be ungoogleable. Luxury has to be about insider information. And that's why I say, if you know, you know. Knowledge and access, not wealth, are the new cultural currency. So the new status is actually being in the know and knowing about things and knowing about experiences. Today's high velocity consumer is challenging current retail models with new values and new rules. And this is more true now than ever before. And these shifts that are happening are extremely important if you are working in the world of branding and creating consumer experiences, because these shifts really are indicative of the mindset of this new kind of way of consuming. So from a consumer to a member, consumers seek social connections through like-minded peers, through brands, products, and experiences. And that, again, today, more than ever before, people are wanting to connect, even though, ironically, we're more unconnected than we've ever been because of this quarantine that we're going through on a global basis. So that's another thing that's actually astounding about the situation right now, is that everybody, the whole world, is suffering the same problem. And more than ever, we are looking for ways, just like today, through Zoom, to connect. from transaction. So this is in particular about retail and consumption, from transaction to interaction. Doing is the new buying, with impactful experiences engaging and entertaining consumers. Today, more than ever, there's stuff everywhere. You can buy anything, anytime, any place. So what is it that you're, what creates the choice between one product and brand and another? And that is very much about engaging with the brand in emotional level and being part of the experience and being part of the creation of the brand itself. From static to shareable, and I think everybody knows what this means, by transforming the ordinary into the extraordinary, consumers come together through highly shareable moments. This is about creating visually. We are a generation that has never been more creative ever in the history of the planet. Young people today produce the most amazing things. If you go on social media, my partner's a filmmaker, it is unbelievable what people are making nowadays at an amateur level, but at a professional executional level. Shareability and creating word of mouth is one of the key things to becoming a premium brand today, but with the proper group of people. So you'll see what I'm talking about in a minute. From need to narrative, meaningful, valuable, and emotive storytelling at every touch point on the consumer journey. Up until this point, especially here in the West, the world has been incredibly rich. People have everything they need. There is an inundation of products and services. And I think we're becoming more and more aware of it. It was already beginning to happen before the whole coronavirus situation hit. Everyone was talking about retail Armageddon and everything is breaking down. All it is an oversaturated level of products and services in the market. There's just too much of everything. So the way you separate and the way you differentiate is by telling a great story about your brand. Meaningful, valuable, and emotive storytelling content, in terms of how you present yourselves, is the key factor between a consumer deciding between which brand to buy. High velocity consumers seek inspiring brand experiences over aspirational products. This is really the most important statement you can make. Products nowadays are the souvenirs of the experience. Exclusivity comes from being invited to an event, knowing where something secret is happening, understanding who the peer group and being connected to that group about a certain type of experience versus the product. The product is the takeaway of saying, I was there. Knowledge and access to those experiences are today's cultural currency. Today's status is cultural currency. Having cultural currency and being in the know and being in places that most people don't know about, that are ungoogleable, is the new status. Inspiration is now the aspiration, experience is the product. This statement is also critical. People want to be inspired. That is what they're actually buying when they buy products. Today, I know coronavirus and everything has come to a grinding halt. And I think today, more than ever, this transformation of adding value beyond just the purchase of a product, beyond just what something costs, is the key to success going forward. People are going to look for things post-coronavirus that add and enhance to their lives, not just own. What does this mean for retail? And we're going to talk a little bit about it right now. So if you know, you know. And the first case study I have, and please forgive me, I have a lot of videos. That's normally how I present. I don't normally present in this kind of format. Videos are going to be very choppy. I hope you're going to be able to see the video. Don't worry, I have still images that come after the video, but I want to show the video because it's very, very important that you understand how the customer journey takes place. These are stores and locations that are not just about buying something. They're about going to the place in the physical form and experiencing it yourself. That's a huge shift from all the talk about digital, digital, digital. And I think in particular, post-corona, everyone is going to be really hungry to get out of their house, to experience things, to go back to restaurants, to touch and feel and smell and be connected to people in the physical IRL, as they say. And I think these stores are way ahead of the curve because they've created experiences that can only really be seen and felt when you're there. And Bodega, I came back from a retail tour in LA, and Bodega was a fantastic store. The first time I went to try to find it, I couldn't find it. The second time, I found it. So that tells you how hard this is to find, and you'll see what I mean. And I love their motto, hidden in plain sight. This is luxury streetwear in LA's produce district. And this is really about new luxury in every sense of the word. It will not be recognizable as luxury, because this looks so different. And this is all about elevating the overall experience, getting rid of all the 19th century cues of elegance and blah, 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 I'm so fancy and everything, you know. It's more about this kind of really being in the know and understanding what is being presented, because this is something that maybe your grandparents would not recognize as a luxury experience. I don't know how old you guys are out there. I'm pretty old, as you can see. But this is about youth and what they value as aspirational and something that they really want to acquire. There's a little video here. It'll take 1 minute 30 seconds. Bear with me. I hope it plays well for you. So you can see that this is pretty much unidentifiable as being a luxury store. It is a store in the produce warehouse district of Los Angeles. It is a store that carries incredibly exclusive streetwear. I don't know if any of you follow high snobriety, but you know that some of the sneakers out there can be $5,000, $6,000, $7,000, much more than most luxury products are. This is the kind of store that those kinds of products are sold in. The entrance looks exactly like the rest of the warehouses in that district. And that's what's so exciting. It's hidden in plain view. It's in a place where you would never expect to buy luxury products. It's in a place where you really have to make an effort to seek out, or you are in the know and your friends tell you, go here, go there. They text you, they let you know where you can visit. And you can see that the interior is, again, nothing like you expect. All of this, by the way, is artificial and created through art direction. So in a lot of ways, this store has, even though it looks like a low-level bodega, has an extremely high level in terms of execution and art direction. The inside is impeccable. I have to tell you, I visited, and you can see from these photographs that it looks exactly like just a crappy little bodega. But what's so brilliant about this is they've also incorporated their own branded products into this bodega environment. And that creates a mystique, an excitement. This is the souvenir saying, I've been here. This creates a kind of halo around not only the brands that they sell, but also around the brand bodega itself. You were there, you found it, you were able to visit. The rest of the store is pretty interesting as well. It has a mixture of, as you can see here, a showcase for the high-level sneakers that they sell, very clean, very simple, very easy to navigate, areas for art, lounging, and socializing. The upper floor is primarily apparel, so this is a two-story store, which again, most, you know, this is a streetwear store. This is enormous for the kind of product that they're selling. And people are very, very excited about visiting this location because it's a very exciting place that's not only about buying, but about being with a group of people. And you can see here some guys playing ping pong. What store in the world dedicates a ping pong table to, you know, something that would normally have a high turnover? The other thing that they understand so well is that people not only buy in the physical realm, but also buy in the digital realm. That fluidity between the digital and the physical happens very easily, especially for this target consumer. For them, they don't have a problem buying the product in the store on their phone and have it delivered to their home, but they're in the store experiencing a different level of retail than you would normally experience from other brands. OCD Cleaners is one of those very interesting brands, and the Bodega sponsors pop-ups within their store. And so OCD Cleaners, as you can see, that's the name of their brand, made an actual cleaner or dry cleaner to sell their products. Here you see they sell repurposed clothing, again, very timely in terms of this idea of being socially conscious. On the left side, you see the announcement, the flyer, quote unquote, or the invitation, quote unquote, for this event. For the pop-up event. And you can see that it looks, again, like flyers from festivals. It has the same kind of language that a particular consumer base really understands and views as premium. Okay, I've been told that I have someone.
How do you go to the Q&A?
I don't know. My producer's telling me I need to go into the Q&A. I'm going to just keep going, and then maybe we can take all these questions at the end, if that's okay for everybody. You'll also see that instead of thank you for shopping, thank you for copying. I don't know how many of you shop on Instagram or social media, but it's like a cop or drop usually. So it's, you know, you like something or not. And they understand, again, that language of the digital consumer. Leclerc. I don't know how many of you visit Paris. This is the granddaddy of all these kinds of hidden retail experiences, hidden luxury experiences. It's been in Paris now for many, many years, almost, I would say, maybe 20 years. They've been doing this particular type of experience. Leclerc has four locations in Paris, and this particular location is the one that's hidden. This is the one that is for the VVVIP, that can go have private fittings. They also have a hospitality experience that goes with it. I'll play a little video and then we can talk about it as soon as the video is over. Also, they're the ones that came up with this idea of rough luxury. Before even Prada created the store in New York, they were the ones that led the way with this kind of raw, highly authentic type of luxury. You'll see what I'm talking about in a second. This is a store that's located near Place Victoire in the garment district of Paris. As you can see, it's a very nondiscreet door, no sign other than on the buzzer. You walk right by this in Paris. It looks like many, many other doors in Paris. But once inside, you are kind of welcomed into this almost looking like through the looking glass type of Alice in Wonderland experience. You really enter this other world that's both exciting because it's so creative and artistic, but also the level of product presentation in terms of exclusive brands. These are more exclusive than any of the normal kind of luxury brands that you would recognize, like a Vuitton or da, 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 da. This is really the gourmet of the gourmet. And we're talking about products that are very limited and also have the cue of rough luxury. So again, no big logos, very understated, those who know will know what you're wearing. It's a place that's incredibly welcoming, despite the fact that it's so exclusive. I've been there many, many times, and I remember the first time I went, I purchased a very small item. It wasn't very expensive. I went back 6 months later, and they remembered my name and said, "Welcome back." It was astounding how friendly the service was. And this leads me to another point, that today, luxury, if you are here, they already know that you have a certain mindset. They're not going to discriminate against you because you're not wearing expensive clothes. The fact that you're in the store and that you know their location means that you seek them out. And in a way, they welcome everyone. So it's really not a place where, new luxury is not about this kind of snobby exclusivity that we've known in the past, with the red ropes in front of the door and only certain people can be let in and da 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 da. This is really about a very inclusive, yet at the same time exclusive way of handling luxury. This is, again, in the middle of the store, a huge kitchen counter. They serve fabulous gourmet wines, cheeses, all kinds of delicious French food while you're being fitted for your clothes. Now, granted, you're probably not going to escape this store without under 10 grand if you're wearing an outfit, but nevertheless, this is a really high level experience. They also have this huge kitchen dining area in the space, and they're more than happy to rent this out to anyone who has the right chef. So if you know, or you have a chef that you're going to have a party with that maybe is renowned, they actually will even give you the space to use for your party, because for them, that helps elevate their brand halo, as well as attract potentially new customers to the store. So a completely different way of strategizing around how you get consumers to your space. The last one I'm going to show you is my personal favorite. I mean, I really love Bodega, but I really like this store because the guys who opened the store, it's two guys, it's really new. I hope they make it through this crisis. They primarily used to sell online, and what they started being, what they were originally, were stylists for films and movies. They started an online business so that people could access the really cool underground brands that they were carrying, and then opened the space in the LA Art District. So this district in Los Angeles is very interesting. There's a Soho House, there's a Dover Street Market, there's all these kind of new luxury experiences within the vicinity that you would never recognize as being a location where you would go for luxury. And that's why I call this digital luxury, because they really bridge the gap between the digital and the physical space. Show you a little quick video. This is probably the most hidden of all the stores, and you'll see what I mean. You don't even see the store entrance, because the store entrance is actually another store. So you have to go through a coffee shop to get to the store, and you'll see in a second. So you see that this store is actually the storage area of the coffee shop. The coffee shop is called Maru Coffee. It's owned by a couple of Japanese guys. They make the most incredible coffee, some of the best in Los Angeles. You enter through this wonderful kind of minimalist space, almost zen-like, again, premium coffee, so very much a premium experience. And what's interesting here is that the hospitality experience is actually attached to the retail. So what's nice is that if you have a very high level customer and you want to treat them to, again, this kind of immersive lifestyle experience, both the coffee shop and departamento, the brand, are parallel in terms of the kind of perspective they have and the target audience they're looking for. So you can see here, very nice. And there's the door, there's the entrance. You don't even get a sign when you walk in. It's just a yellow light. And then you know they're open. You walk in and you enter a space that's a pretty raw gallery-like space. Again, it's not like we haven't seen this before from like a Dover Street Market or those types of luxury experiences. But again, here, what's really important is the product selection. They really focus on buying brands as the guys, I talked to one of the owners and he basically said, because I said, you know, how do you do this? How do you stay in business? Because you're completely hidden from the street. You're in an area that doesn't even have, you know, the normal kind of walk-by traffic that you would expect in retail. And on top of that, you're in the back of a coffee shop. And he said that it's not a problem for them because basically what they do is they carry brands that customers are fans of. People are waiting for the latest drop of the kinds of brands that they carry in their store. In addition to that, they also are experts at online shopping. So they, again, they have this very fluid approach between online and offline. And this is the dressing room. This is one of the dressing rooms in the space. And you can see here, if you were a VIP, if you were an emerging movie star in LA, and you were hip and young and gorgeous, this is a place you'd want to go with your friends to try on whatever, you know, ensemble you were going to wear to the latest opening, event, party, whatever it might be. So you can see that they really understand who their customer is and cater to that. Customers today are getting anything, can get anything anywhere. Customers today can get anything anywhere and they want to be inspired. So again, going back to this idea, inspiration is now the aspiration, high velocity consumers seek inspiring brand experiences over aspirational products. All the stores I showed you today carry products that you can get if you're a real fashionista. If you love fashion, anyone can buy products anywhere. It's not that these stores carry something, well, sometimes they do carry things that only they carry. But the point of this is that these are experiences that are far beyond just shopping. They're much more than transactional. They're really about not even necessarily selling products. What they are about, and this, I think this is a very important quote if you're a retailer, retail is no longer about the distribution of products because products can be bought online. Just go on to Amazon, right? It's about the acquisition of brand ambassadors. So these stores are about creating the kinds of things that Departamento was talking about. Fans. People want to be fans. They want to belong to a group. They want to feel like they have a certain type of exclusivity. And a lot of these stores have a huge range of price points. They have everything from, you know, maybe a couple hundred bucks to, you know, thousands of bucks for, you know, a jacket or whatever it might be. Today's status has a price, but it's about social currency, knowledge, and access as opposed to wealth. So even though these stores are not obviously H&M, but nevertheless, what they are about, what they're focusing on is the social currency that they create. And I can show you six or seven other stores. Kith is another great example of a retailer in LA that is quite hidden, quite inaccessible, but again, carries all kinds of exciting products and price ranges for anyone that can enter the store knows where they are. So it isn't about what you have, but about what you know. Those who know, search for the ungoogleable. So that's my presentation. There's an email here at the bottom of it, hannah.weissman@uxus.com. If you'd like to have a copy of this presentation, we're happy to send it. Please contact Hannah if you're interested. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to unshare my screen. And then if you guys have any questions about anything, I'm happy to answer anything any questions you might have. Let's see. I can't pronounce your name, but the first question is, creating new experiences and exclusive spaces like Bodega is exciting. However, how can established heritage brands emulate some of those experiences into their day-to-day engagements with consumers? We can all do pop-ups, but even then the pop-up space has limitations. Yes, you are correct. It is a difficult thing to do today. The kinds of experiences that those brands are proposing take a lot of work. But at the same time, I think that retail today, I mean, a great example of a volume, well, not a huge volume retailer, but nevertheless, a retailer that is emerging as a powerhouse, and you don't see them so much here in the West, they're quite big in Asia, is Gentle Monster. And Gentle Monster has been able to create an incredible balance between volume and experience. And I don't know how many of you have been into a Gentle Monster store, but they are incredibly shareable, exciting. I go to them just to see the presentation level that they are offering in the store. All they sell are eyeglasses, so it's a one product type of experience. Yet they've been able to navigate this kind of experiential world in a very powerful way, and so powerful that LVMH invested $60 million into their brand. I think LVMH understands that there's a lot to learn from brands like Gentle Monster. Anonymous attendee, hi George. Hi George. Thank you for your time. How do you think will the current crisis affect luxury retail? Oh yeah, it's going to affect it big time. Will consumers go back to business as usual or completely change their behavior, perspective of what they expect from a retail experience? I think they're going to change their perspective in a major way. And not only from the experience themselves, but also from the kinds of products that they buy. I think, I don't have a crystal ball. I can't tell you what is going to happen past this crisis, but there's a lot of people already who have lost jobs. So the fact that people will not have means to support themselves in terms of buying luxury products has a very big impact on the kinds of products you buy. A lot of people will not feel very comfortable walking down the street with a big old Hermes bag that costs $21,000 on their arm when you have, hundreds of thousands of people potentially out of work or not having the financial means anymore to support themselves. Let's hope that this crisis doesn't leave the economy completely devastated and that people will come out of this experience unscathed. I think this crisis has also brought to the attention of what really matters in life, that it's not necessarily about buying expensive things, but more about sharing and creating memories. And I think that retail and the kinds of experiences that I just showed you are about those kinds of memory creations. They're hidden, they're special. Remember when we went to Bodega in LA and we got this really cool sneaker? It's so much more than just buying a sneaker. So I think that yes, there will be a huge change in the way people buy and the kinds of products they will be buying. More understated, more about subtle cues of status. What if you had, Amy Dubin. Thank you, Amy, for saying that my presentation is brilliant. I love you already, Amy. But with everything closed, what recommendations might you have for switching instantly online? I don't know. I mean, all I can say is that the guys that I spoke to in all of these locations, as well as some of the other brands that I didn't show you today, it's all about creating community. I know that we've been hearing a lot about this, like, brands need to reach out and create community, blah, blah, blah. But all, these people really do. I mean, people love these stores. They go to them not just to buy, but because it's a social activity. So creating community is so important. And what you can do is what these brands have the ability to do, again, it's like it's fluid between the physical space and online. So that transition, because of this idea of community, is very, very seamless. I hope that answered your question. I'm sorry if I don't know that much about the digital world, unfortunately. Look at me, I'm gray and old. Grace Bryan, what are the three most essential parts of an experience, i.e. Instagrammable moment, unique product, free product? Yes, all. Today, it's all about multi-dimension. You cannot have one thing. You need to be Instagrammable. You need to have amazing service. You need to have unique branded services. You need to have incredible products. You need to have stuff you give away. You need to have incredible environments. Yeah, all of it. I mean, to the retail in the future, especially after this corona crisis, I think is going to be more challenging than ever. The first thing out of people's mind isn't going to be like, oh my God, I got to go buy a Gucci bag. You know what I mean? So I think what will happen to retail is that it will become much more about that experience, about that memory creation that I was telling you a little bit about earlier. How is digital signage adapted in premium retail? Actually, I didn't see any. To be perfectly honest, the digital signage in-store in these locations doesn't exist because the digital experience for them is on your device. So they want you to walk out of the store with their brand in your hand, not about screens and, you know, touch. I mean, I know that there's a lot of retailers out there doing touch screens that, you know, you could, the endless, you know, shop online in the store. Okay. That probably was how people were thinking when digital started emerging as a force in retail. But I would tell you today that the consumer now wants all of that on their device. They want to walk out. The person who's a fan of Departamento doesn't care about touching a screen in store. They want to try on a million things so that when they leave the store, they might buy those things after or even during on their phone. Grace Bryan, what are the three most essential parts of an experience, i.e., oh, I already read that. Let's see. How do we start? How do startup brands with smaller budget emulate the sense of luxury and consumer experience? I think that these brands do have a smaller budget. Like the Departamento guys, they're on a shoestring. And what they were able to do is they were able to build a reputation. Again, creating a community around like-minded consumers who are looking for certain types of products who they have access to, and they are able to present and sell to them. So this is not an expensive store, and I have a, and the, one of the reasons why they're in back of the coffee house is because their buddies who had the coffee house have all that extra space, and they're actually all friends. And what they are doing, the coffee, Maru Coffee, is subletting the retail store to the guys at Departamento. So they're getting it for a very, very good price. Everything's on a shoestring. Obviously, filling an entire store full of product costs a lot of money because you have to pay for all that. Maybe they don't. They said, they told me that they have incredibly good relationships with these brands. So I think more than ever, people who have creativity and who have the ability to create an experience because they are connected to a social group have the ability to create this new luxury experience, much more than big brands. This is not about high-end, expensive environments that are all about, you know, really famous art that costs, you know, well, I mean, I also, if you go to Rick Owens or there's another store in LA called Just One Eye that is filled with original Damien Hirst that were made for the owner of the store, you know, it doesn't have to be that way. It's exciting. It's amazing to see art that is created for these types of stores, but it's not necessarily about something expensive. This is about understanding who your target audience is, understanding what their aspirations are, and creating an experience, handmade and human experience, because that is actually what is rare, not the big commercial ta-dams that you always see. I hope that answers your question. Please let me know if I'm not answering the questions. I'm happy to respond again. What is the best approach of getting your product carried by these retail stores? Just contact them directly. All these guys are super open, nice guys. I mean, they gave me all their cards and they said, email me whenever you want and ask me whatever you want. They're, if you have products, I would go and just solicit them directly, because even if you don't necessarily sell it to them, you can also put it on consignment. There's a lot of ways. We're talking about the 21st century now. There's a lot of ways to handle seeding products into these types of retail stores. These are still artisanal stores that are led by real people. They're not big corporations. They love artisanal designers who create one-of-a-kind products, because that only makes their store more special and even more luxurious. Because it, again, it's not about price, it's about rarity and exclusivity in the sense of crafted, human, one-of-a-kind products. That's why, I don't know if you guys, you know, there's resale and there's wholesale, right? So we're talking about wholesale right now. Resale is booming. Resale before the crisis was actually exceeding wholesale pace. Why? It's the treasure hunt. It's going into a secondhand vintage store and finding that amazing piece that only you have. So if you're a new brand out there and you want to get your products into these stores, I think, you know, you have a really good shot, especially nowadays. Grace Bryan, thank you. Fantastic talk. Thank you, Grace. Thank everybody for listening to my ramble. If you have any more questions or if you want to reach out, please contact Hannah, and we're more than happy to send you this presentation so that you can share it with your friends.